And our reading from Isaiah. Isaiah speaks words of protection and restoration to the people of Israel who have been in exile in Babylon for many, many years. Isaiah speaks, "But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you." I've titled today's reflection, Stories to Tell. And I begin the message with a personal word. I have struggled over the past few weeks with being the one to speak today, because as a cisgender person, that is, as one who identifies with the sex I was assigned at birth, I don't have the personal knowledge or life experiences to provide a foundation for what I say. However, with ongoing COVID concerns, which has meant that St. James isn't having in-person services at this time, however that's about to change, and I'll speak to that in the announcement time, I had to make the difficult decision to not invite a guest speaker this year. The good news is, as I've prepared this service, I've been so blessed to have the patient teaching of Autumn and Andy, spouses, both of whom have been our guests in previous years. To them both, if they watch this later, thank you. I am deeply grateful. Today we are remembering our transgender siblings who have died during 2021, as well as remembering those who daily struggle against transphobia, harassment, ignorance, discrimination, and violence. As well, we are remembering that each of us has a part to play in ending transgender violence and transphobia by confronting our own feelings, as well as challenging any outdated or misinformed ideas we may have. First, some background on the Transgender Day of Remembrance, or TDOR, as it is also known. Transgender Day of Remembrance was started in 1999 by transgender advocate Gwendolyn Ann Smith as a vigil to honor the memory of Rita Hester, a transgender woman who was killed in 1998. The vigil commemorated all the transgender people lost to violence in that first year after Rita's death, and began an important tradition that has become the annual Transgender Day of Remembrance. In the words of Gwendolyn Ann Smith, "Transgender Day of Remembrance seeks to highlight the losses we face due to anti-transgender bigotry and violence. I am no stranger to the need to fight for our rights, and the right to simply exist is first and foremost. With so many seeking to erase transgender people, sometimes in the most brutal ways possible, it is vitally important that those we lose are remembered, and that we continue to fight for justice End of quote. Today, I'd like us to meet two transgender persons and hear their stories. I've chosen these two people not because their stories are any more or any less important than anyone else's stories, but because their stories have helped me as a cisgender person to learn about my transgender siblings and their lived experiences. The first person is Jazz Jennings. I read the children's story that Jazz co-authored during the all ages time. Jazz is one of the youngest and most prominent voices in the national discussion about gender identity. She's an American. While she had been assigned male at birth, Jazz made it clear as soon as she could speak that she was female. At the age of 5, Jazz transitioned to life as a girl with the support of her parents. In 2007, her parents allowed her to share her incredible journey in her first Barbara Walters interview, aired at a time when the public was much less knowledgeable or accepting of the transgender community. This groundbreaking interview was followed over the years by other high-profile interviews, a documentary, the launch of her YouTube channel, publication of the picture book I read, and her own reality TV series, I Am Jazz, which I believe is still running. Today, Jazz is one of the most recognizable activists for transgender teens, children, and adults. In her memoir, Being Jazz, My Life as a Transgender Teen, Jazz reflects on these very public experiences and how they have helped shape the mainstream attitude toward the transgender community. But it hasn't all been easy. Jazz has faced many challenges, bullying, discrimination, and rejection. Yet she perseveres as she educates others about her life as a transgender teen. Through it all, her family has been beside her on her journey, standing together against those who don't understand the true meaning of tolerance and unconditional love. In 2007, Jazz and her parents founded Trans Kids Purple Rainbow Foundation to assist transgender youth. And in 2014, Time magazine named Jazz one of the 25 most influential teens of the year for inspiring people to accept the differences in others while embracing their own truths. The second person I'd like you to meet is someone you may have already met. Perhaps during the years she served Wesley United Church here in Regina, Reverend Cindy Bourgeois. Cindy is the first known or openly transgender person ordained by the United Church. In her May 5th, 2021 blog titled, Wishing for a Better World, Cindy writes, I realized I was trans when I was 11. It came suddenly to me. This was the early 1970s, and while our media likes to suggest trans children came into existence around 2005, I was a transgender child in the 1970s. I was devastated. I couldn't understand my feelings, my desire to be a girl. I wished and wished that these feelings would go away and that I could be normal. But the call to express myself was clearer than any siren call in Greek mythology. And so I did. And when I did, there was a feeling of relief, of contentment, and a feeling of peace. However, When forced to return to the world, these feelings would be followed by feelings of shame and depression. The psychiatric industry has created a label which they call gender dysphoria. The theory is that I and other trans people are unhappy with our bodies, and this causes dysphoria, and that along with this dysphoria comes shame and depression. Well, there can be no arguing with the extremely high rate of depression among trans people. I am not sure that the psychiatrists are right. You see, when I finally could not handle the depression and anxiety and came out as trans in my middle age, my depression and anxiety began to fade. I still have good days and bad days, good times and bad times, but since transitioning, my depression has definitely decreased. In fact, you might say that expressing myself as who I am has cured my chronic depression. What I am suggesting is that my depression was not caused by gender dysphoria or hating my body, but instead by a transphobic society that would not allow me to express myself. My depression was a logical and helpful response to being an object of ridicule in the media. By being told that I am a threat to cisgender women by so-called radical feminists, and that I am an abomination by conservative Christians. My depression has little to do with trans and everything to do with being hated by the society in which I live. Cindy concludes, I wonder what it would mean that instead of wishing I am not trans, I wished I lived in a world where transphobia was no more. I wonder what it would mean if everybody who doesn't hate trans people wished for a world where being trans was not only accepted, but perhaps even celebrated. Maybe if we did that, we could improve not only my mental health, but the mental health of every trans person who is struggling in this broken world. End of quote. Well, in a few moments, we will be remembering and honoring 44 beloved trans persons who were killed in the United States thus far in 2021. Organizations who track the deaths of transgender persons estimate that by year's end, the United States will exceed 54 deaths of transgender persons. And there are almost 400 recorded deaths of transgender persons around the world. As we hear their names, it's important that we remember that violence against transgender persons occurs not just in the United States, but worldwide. One of the horrendous places where violence occurs is in Brazil, but also including here in Canada. Transgender persons are killed by acquaintances, partners, or strangers. Some are clearly the victims of anti-transgender bias, while the transgender status of others have put them at risk in other ways, such as forcing them into unemployment, poverty, homelessness, and survival sex work. Jazz and Cindy's stories need to be a call to action for all of us. But perhaps, like myself, you are wondering how to help bring about a world in which transphobia is no more, and where transgender people are not only accepted, but celebrated. Well, one resource that I have found helpful is an organization called GLAAD, G-L-A-A-D, an American organization that has been at the forefront of cultural change, accelerating acceptance for the LGBTQ community for over 30 years. I've also listed some organizations at the end of the bulletin, and I believe Patty has also put those names of those organizations on our webpage. Yes, she's nodding. Thank you, Patty. So I encourage you to check them out. There's lots of educational and helpful information there for us all to read. Anyway, GLAAD offers a number of tips for allies of transgender persons, including the following. Don't make assumptions about a transgender person's sexual orientation. If you don't know what pronouns to use, listen first. Don't ask a transgender person what their real name is. Be careful about confidentiality, disclosure, and outing. Respect the terminology that a transgender person uses to describe their identity. Challenge anti-transgender remarks or jokes in public spaces, including the LGB spaces. Support all gender restrooms. Listen to transgender people. Know your own limits as an ally. And this tip from Autumn, when I was speaking to her a couple of weeks ago, be more kind with your words and more cognizant of your actions. As disciples of Jesus, you and I are called to live agape love for our transgender siblings through our words, actions, and our presence. Individually and together, we are called to use our learning and our understanding to assist in building a just and caring society in which every transgender person is free from discrimination, harassment, and threats of violence. May it be so. Amen. I'm going to call Alan forward to assist me with our memorial time. First, a brief introduction. May the souls of all we remember this day be blessed. We call to mind today, young and old, of every race and faith, those who identify as transgender, those who have died of violence by another's hand or by their own hand. We mourn their senseless deaths and give thanks for their precious lives, for their teachings, and for the brief glow of each holy flame. We pray for the strength to carry on their legacy of vision, bravery, and love. And as we remember them, we resolve to root out the injustice, ignorance, and cruelty that grows despair. We pray also for those who perpetrate hate and violence. May all come to appreciate and understand that creation has many holy expressions. Blessed are those who have let their divine image shine in the world. We remember now those whom death has taken from us, those who are the victims of transphobic violence. Tiana Alexander, 28-year-old Black trans woman, shot to death in Chicago on January 6th. Samuel Edmund Damian Valentine, transgender man, killed in Trujillo, Alto, Puerto Rico. My Spanish is appalling, I apologize. On January 9th. Bianca Muffin Banks, Black transgender woman shot to death in Atlanta, Georgia on January 17th.
Dominique Jackson, Black transgender woman, shot to death in Jackson, Mississippi on January 25th. 50 Bands, 21-year-old Black transgender woman, killed in Baton Rouge, Louisiana on January 28th. Alexis Braxton, 45-year-old Black trans woman, killed in Miami, Florida on February 4th.
China Carrillo, 25 years old, killed in the morning hours of February 18th in New Wilmington, Pennsylvania. Siblings, Jeffrey J.J. Bright, a 16-year-old trans boy, and Jasmine Kennedy, a 20-year-old non-binary person, both from Ambridge, Pennsylvania, were killed on February 22nd. Jenna Franks, 34-year-old white transgender woman, killed in Jacksonville, North Carolina, in February.
Diamond Kyrie Sanders, 23-year-old black transgender woman, shot to death in Cincinnati, Ohio on March 3rd. Brianna Parker, 26-year-old Latina trans woman, killed on March 17th in Los Angeles, California. Jada Peterson, 29-year-old black trans woman, killed on April 4th in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Dominique Luscious, 26-year-old black transgender woman, shot and killed on April 8th in Springfield, Missouri. Remy Fennell, black transgender woman in her 20s, I guess, shot to death on April 15th in Charlotte, North Carolina. Tierra Banks, 24-year-old black transgender woman, shot multiple times and killed on April 21st in Chicago, Illinois.
Natalie Smut, 24-year-old black and Puerto Rican transgender woman, killed on April 23rd in Matipas, California. Iris Santos, 22-year-old Latinx transgender woman, killed in Houston, Texas on April 23rd. Tiffany Thomas, 38-year-old black transgender woman, killed on April 24th in Dallas, Texas.
Carrie Washington, 49-year-old black transgender woman, killed on May 1st in Clearwater, Florida. Jahera DeAlto, 42-year-old transgender woman, killed on May 2nd in Boston, Massachusetts. Whispering Wind Bear Spirit, 41-year-old indigenous non-binary person, shot in York, Pennsylvania on May 3rd and died early on May 4th.
Sophie Vasquez, 36-year-old Latina transgender woman, shot and killed in Georgia on May 4th. Danica Danny Henson, 31-year-old black transgender woman, shot and killed in Baltimore, Maryland on May 4th. Serenity Hobbs, 24-year-old black transgender woman, shot and killed in Albany, Georgia on May 8th.
Oliver Ollie Taylor, 17-year-old white trans boy, died on May 19th after being kidnapped and shot on May 12th in Gervais, Oregon. Thomas Harden, 35-year-old black transgender woman, killed on May 2nd in York, South Carolina. Poe Black, 21-year-old transgender man, killed in Niland, California in early May. His body was found on May 11th.
E.J. Boykin, killed in Lynchburg, Virginia on June 14th. He just recently celebrated his 23rd birthday. Aileen Evans, 24-year-old black transgender woman, found dead in March in Port Arthur, Texas. Her death was being investigated as homicide. Kayla Ashton, 20-year-old black trans woman, killed in Suitland, Prince George's County, Maryland, June 17th.
Shay Vanderpump, 23-year-old black trans woman, killed in Trenton, New Jersey on July 30th. Tierra Marie Lewis, 36-year-old black trans woman, killed in Cleveland, Ohio on June 12th. Miss Coco, 44-year-old trans woman of color, killed in Dallas, Texas on August 7th.
Pooh Johnson, 25-year-old black trans woman, killed in Shreveport, Louisiana on August 23rd. Desea Mane, 32-year-old black transgender woman, fatally shot in Chicago, Illinois on September 6th. Brianna Hamilton, 25-year-old black transgender woman, fatally shot in Chicago, Illinois.
Pierre Laprie Cartier, 21-year-old black transgender woman, fatally shot in Arlington, Texas on September 30th. Mel Groves, 25-year-old black trans man, fatally shot on October 11th. Royal Poetical Stars, 26-year-old black trans woman, fatally shot in Miami Gardens, Florida on October 2nd.
Zoea Zoe Rose Martinez, 20-year-old Latina trans woman, fatally shot in Maple Valley, Washington on August 31st. Her body was later found in Seattle. Joe Acker, 26-year-old white transgender woman, killed in Boise, Idaho on October 26th. Jesse Hart, 42-year-old white transgender woman, killed in Banks, Oregon. Her body was found on October 17th. Ricky Otamuro, 39-year-old Latina transgender woman, fatally shot in Centralia, Washington on the night of October 30th or the morning of October 31st.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan. My heart is heavy as I hear our siblings' names. Perhaps yours is feeling heavy as well. Understandably so, if it is. We need to take some time to reflect, but also to care for ourselves as we reflect, and to feel what we feel. And I am always here if anyone wants to talk. And while we're having a time of silent reflection, Christine is going to support us in our reflection with some of her beautiful music. Friends, I'd like to invite you to share in the responsive words following our act of remembrance. In honoring and remembering each life, we affirm that the worth of each person whose life has ended, as well as our remembering, has brought us closer to the source of life, in whose unity no one is alone and every life finds purpose. We acknowledge that there are thousands more whom we cannot name. We mourn the senseless deaths by all, some by another's hand, and some by their own. We give thanks for each and every life, for their teaching, and for the glow of each person's holy flame. Blessed are they who allow their divine flame to shine in the world. Amen. Our song of response, like a river of tears, our spirits will be renewed. It's More Voices, number 98. Contact tracing if needed. If not fully vaccinated or not feeling well, you are encouraged to attend the services online. There will be no paper bulletins, except of course for the minister and the choir and the musicians and the choir director, and maybe the deaf people do, I don't know. But there will be a PowerPoint again, so the folks who come will be able to participate and know what's going on. And also, we have the pews marked with green tape, so please sit where the green tape is. Green for go, that isn't go leave, that means go and sit there. And there will not be coffee, there won't be coffee time after the church, at least for the time being. Did I get that right, Richard?
I believe you did.
Okay, anything to add?
I think that's good.
Okay. Richard is the chair of our council and he's doing a slam dunk job. So, thank you, Richard. All right, and we have some council members actually sitting in this sanctuary today. And perhaps those of you watching online, anyway, a reminder that there's a council meeting this coming Thursday by Zoom. We won't know how to meet in person again after all of these Zoom meetings. You know, it'll be like, I don't know, the Brady Bunch or something. We'll all be Zooming up there. Sunday school continues. And the good news, folks, is that Health Canada has just approved vaccinations for children between the ages of 5 and 11. So if that will help parents to feel a little more comfortable to bring their children. Rowan's having a great time. She's an awesome Sunday school teacher. And I'm sure she wouldn't mind a few more children, you know, spending some of Sunday with her. So please pre-register if you want to bring your children. The Rainbow Youth Center Christmas Stocking Project is underway. There's a number of things down at the base of the pulpit. The donations are coming in slowly but surely. Thank you to those who have brought something. The last day to drop off your donations is Friday, December 3rd. So please, you've got lots of time. It's a wonderful project to support. Margaret will be here at the church Tuesdays and Friday mornings from 9 to 11:30 a.m. So the church will be open for you to drop off your donations. There's lots of things that are needed, like toothpaste and toothbrush, etc. Brushes, so. Offering envelopes are also available for the coming year for pickup in the church office, again, Tuesdays and Friday mornings from 9 to 11:30 a.m. And we have resumed Wednesday morning Zoom coffee. So that's fabulous to catch up with folks. If you don't mind having your coffee in front of your computer on Wednesday mornings, we'd love to have you join us. Book group is continuing. We still need Facebook live stream volunteers, right? Yeah, Patty's nodding. There are other things going on in the wider community. I'm just going to commend those to your attention. Yes, because it's a long service today. Oh, I did want to say something though about an annual thing that the United Church is doing, and it's called Gifts with Vision. Here is the Gifts with Vision catalog. And it's a really neat thing that the United Church developed in response to members' requests to be able to give gifts to relatives, friends, and loved ones that are in direct support of the church's mission and service partners across Canada and around the world. So, if any one of us, you, myself, others, are seeking inspiring new gift ideas, or perhaps would rather not give family and friends the same old clothes, toys, chocolates, I don't know, chocolate never grows old, does it, Joan? No. So, I mean, you can keep the chocolate coming, but perhaps someone doesn't need another pair of socks, I don't know. Anyway, Gifts with Vision presents a new way to celebrate special occasions like Christmas. You can give a gift that's going to change other people's lives. So, Gifts with Vision, if you just Google that, United Church Canada, you'll find this. And there's probably some catalogs kicking around as well. So, Gifts with Vision, it is the time. All right, friends. Well, you know, if I got paid by the word, I'd be a rich person. No comments from the peanut gallery folks. All right, okay. So, invitations to the offering. It's responsive, so I invite you to join with me in it. Our diversity is a reflection of the infinite mystery of God. We are human. We are divine. We are enlivened by the unbounded creativity of the Holy. We offer our gifts and talents for the work of inclusion, justice, and hope in our world. Thank you for all the ways you support St. James United Church in their many ministries. Thank you. So let us sing. We will take what you offer. We will live by your word. It's kind of perky. Let's have fun with it. You may have seen in the obituaries a couple of weeks ago that a member of our congregation, Evelyn Thompson, died on November 8th. So today I would invite us all, and in the coming days and weeks, to lift Evelyn's family and friends up in our prayers and hold them in our hearts. We also remember Brian Main, who continues to be in hospital, that he feel our love around him, supporting him, and strengthening him. We also think of the communities and persons affected by all the disaster in BC. My husband and I still know people and have friends in Merritt and Princeton, two communities that are underwater. We think of the lives lost in the rock slides. We think of those whose livelihoods are underwater. Wow. For once, I'm without words, actually. The disaster is horrendous. So we think of those folks. And yet, there's good news stories, because the sick community in the areas are making meals and taking them to truck drivers. And, you know, people are stepping up to the plate and helping where they can. So, you know, that gives me hope. That gives me hope that humanity can come forward and help when they're needed to. So let's have a silence and reflection, for the prayers, sacred prayers of our hearts. And maybe a little more quiet music, please, Christine, if you don't mind. I invite you to join with me in renewing our commitment to our trans siblings. Today we recommit ourselves to stand against the headwind of hate, to be a bulwark to end the battering, to see the diverse beauty all around us in every gender and gender-free expression, and in every form of love, to love difference and the journey of becoming, and to learn the new languages that enable and support our beloveds to exist and to thrive. Let us pray. May we have boldness to live our own lives fully and abundantly. May we have passion to work for everyone's abundant life. May we have the courage to walk in solidarity with our trans siblings. May our trans siblings be seen, embraced, and never again be lost to the hurricane of hate. Amen. Friends, our song of going forth love knocks and waits for us to hear. Let us sing this beautiful song. Created in the image of holy love. We go from this place standing with and acting together so that no one will be broken, rejected, or unloved. Love be with you. Normally we would sing peace, but today I'd like us to sing love. Be with you forever.